I'm burned out on Facebook. Burned out on Facebook. Burned out on Facebook. Burned out on Facebook. Yeah, it's Friday night. I'm tired, but I'm burned out on Facebook. Why? Because it's materialism. Materialism has a spirituality. Oh, I love spirituality. So it's spiritual materialism. Or materialistic spiritualism. Materialistic spiritualism. Yeah, there's some good posters here. There's some nice graphics and all this, but the overall culture of the whole world is materialistic spiritualism. And this is a disaster. This is a disaster. It's they think they have the, believe you can have your cake and eat it too. You believe in lies and have truth be the icing on the cake of lies. It doesn't work that way. It's impossible that it ever worked that way. This is what the Dharma Kings are here to tell us. So I don't know what I'm going to do, but it just bogs down in this yoga girl materialistic spiritualism that is epidemic in the world right now. This is what happens when we go into materialism, which is the ego's religion, actually. Religion of the ego. The ego sugarcoats it, of course. Of course it does. It has all these nice quotes, you know. So-and-so says this, so-and-so says this, 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 and that. But where is the culture of actual practice? You might have these modern-day gurus say, you know, don't evaluate yourself. Okay, that's great. Great advice. Super advice. That's full stop in the wow. But where is the practice? Where is it being said, you have every day you have to spend your day immersed in this practice of wow, continual practice. Do not evaluate your progress. Do not evaluate yourself. This is full stop in the wow. So there are some teachers that are advocating full stop in the wow, but they're not explaining it very clearly, and they're not saying you really have to practice this every day. This has to be your focus in life, actually, here. Because they're trying to, you know, cater to materialistic spiritualism. And, oh, you said something profound. That's great. Oh, let's click, you know, click, 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 click. Oh, that's great. I live in a profound world because I can click on this profundity. Okay, that's good. No, we don't even live in a world. We're not even we. You know, we're not people. We're not bodies. We're not personalities. We're not biochemical entities. We're not energy entities at all. We're not human entities at all. None of that. That is all completely absurd. None of that is true. Our identity is completely formless. And this world, again, materialistic spiritualism says how wonderful the world is. That, you know, it's great, but we can make it better. All this nonsense. The world is not, there is no world, number one, because there's no time, space, process, or form. And the purpose of this quote-unquote seeing a world, perceiving a world, is entirely malevolent, actually. It's an attempt to change spirit, what we are. It's an attempt to change the formless into form. It's an attempt to change the eternally timeless into time. It's an attempt to change freedom into process. Okay, how is that good? Is that fair? That's malevolent. So getting free of malevolence is imminently fair. In fact, it's beyond fair. It's absolute necessity. We must awake from this delusion. Yeah, so is it fair? No, it's essential. So the ego says, well, it's not fair that you're, you know, not doing what we tell you to do. That's right, it's not fair. It's essential. That's, see? So essentiality trumps fairness. Totally. Totally. Now, this is what people are grappling with right now is it's and materialistic spiritualism, which is the ego's religion, is dominating this world to an abhorrent extent, actually. And nobody really is standing up, very few, if any, except here is one little oasis in telling it like it really is, telling it like it really is. So the ego always insists, well, it's not fair, it's not fair, it's not fair. We have to, you know, it's not fair for you to be enlightened because we have to do these other stuff too. And so we can't really focus on enlightenment so much. Really, you have to do this other stuff? Why don't you just be a brahmacharya, celibate monk or nun and contemplate, meditate, full stop, and then, wow, nothing's stopping anyone from doing that. It's nonsense to say we have to do this. What do you mean we have to, what, perpetuate this illusion? This attempt to change what we are, which is really a vast despair trap. It's like those yellow jacket traps. You have the scent that attracts yellow jackets in. They go in, they get drowned in the water. They get drowned in despair, the water of despair. This world is just one big yellow jacket trap, actually. I'll tell you the truth. I had to set one of those up today. I insisted that I do it someplace for them as part of my... I don't like doing that. But the yellow jackets are saying, hey, if we can help the Dharma along, we're happy to do so. It's amazing. The insects, the animals, the plants, they all are willing to help the Dharma along, actually. They really are. And they do. They do. They absolutely do. So the yellow jackets are saying, hey, look at the situation of the trap here and realize that's the world. The world is just one big yellow jacket trap. The water's there, the scented water. Oh, they smell it. Oh, how do I get to that? Oh, they go in then they go down and they get to it and suddenly they can't get back out. You know, it's like that. Well, fortunately, we can get back out because actually we never went in. We only dreamed that we went in. We only dreamed. So how much effort do we need to take to free a dream figure from a dream trap? How much time does that take? How much time does that take? Now, it's right now. It's right now. It's right now. It's right now. Really, I have to say, the world is from looking at Facebook and examining the whole thing, not pointing out anyone in particular. There are some good. I've come across some helpful. Of course, everyone's helpful to me. Everyone I come across is helpful. So it's not that people are not helpful. They are. But it's the overall focus is so dualistic, so dualistic. They say, sure, non-dual's great, but dualism's also great, and we need to integrate the two. Like we need to integrate truth and lies. This is what Jesus points out is the sickness of the ego's religion. Very sick indeed. So I keep, you know, but you cannot preach, you know, on Facebook. It's kind of like a community, a certain vibe, like an ant colony, and you can't just come on too strong, because they just ignore you. They just ignore you. Which is the way everything is here, right? If you speak the truth, they will ignore you, and so you kind of get sucked into this, you know, dualistic way of relating. And if we say, well, we'll go somewhere else, they say, that's not fair. And we say, yeah, that's right. It's not fair at all. It's essential. That's what it is. Thanks for clarifying that fairness is not even in play here. And the ego will say, well, that's not what I meant. Well, this is what I mean. So we're headed into Labor Day. Very, very important. And I'm feeling it. I'm feeling this. The day after Labor Day, somehow this came up to me as being a vitally important day, because this is officially, everybody's back in school. The whole United States, the whole election situation is now just going to become ferocious. And, you know, stuff could happen now. It's sort of like it's the end of summer, where we've stumbled through summer somehow. It's been very difficult because we are headed towards this abyss of materialistic spiritualism. Where people think they can have their cake and eat it too. And whoever says, no, you have to do this, and they say, it's not fair, and they say, well, that's right, it's essential They said, "Oh, no, this freaks me out. This will get rid of despair. We have to have despair. We're so used to despair, we think without despair, we'd be like broken in two, as if part of us, one half of us is despair and half of us is hope. Hope and despair, hope and despair, hope and despair. That has nothing to do with what we are. Nothing to do with it. The world has nothing to do with what we are. It tells us nothing about what we are at all. So how can we... Yeah, it's just ridiculous. And it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse exponentially. Now, we have the right practice here, no doubt about it. Full stop in the wow. This is the essential practice. All legitimate teachers, sages, etc., helpers, They all kind of know this, okay. It's what works. It's what works. And they say it in similar ways. But here we're really saying this is the essential practice. Do just this, and become just an expert in that. You do it all the time. We have to be very, very good at it. It just mean good at it means applying it consistently. It doesn't mean we have to do so much of tricks with it. We're not a Rodney Mullen doing a bunch of spin tricks with this. But what we are doing is we're applying it consistently every day to everything that happens. Instead, it's just wow. And then don't evaluate. Don't evaluate our progress, what we are, anything. Don't evaluate it. Don't evaluate. Don't evaluate. There's nothing to evaluate. How do you evaluate freedom? By what measuring stick? Absolute freedom. Can it be evaluated? I'm going to shift this. See if I can get the light settings a little bit. I'm tired of this particular setting. It's a good one. It's just sometimes we want a little different angle on this, a little different angle on this, a little different angle. I don't know how anyone... other than a very, very dedicated, full stop in the wow practicer, under whatever name you want to use for it, label, I don't know how anyone else can escape this religion of the ego that they call the New Age. It's the religion of the ego. That's the New Age. Okay, I'm gonna cool it down. I just feel like cooling this down a little bit. Okay, that's better, isn't it? Yeah. That's a little better. See, it feels cooler, right? Nice. See, we can do something on the fly like this. As I'm taping, and people might think, oh, you know, that's not going to be some smooth, you know, television talk show host talking, and they're so smooth. That's ridiculous. All that stuff is scripted. It's all tightly controlled, tightly produced. They all know what the expectations are, etc. And we all think that that's how it's supposed to be done. It is not. That is a contrivance. Television is such a contrivance. I met someone today, says he, you know, he doesn't watch television. He's got all this stuff. Younger person. I said, that's great. There are people that get it. They understand that what this does. So here, if we don't like, we can just on the fly, just do it on the fly as we're talking. Guess what? That's essential. That's essential. Essential. So adjusting on the fly is very essential. Now I'm trying to get this in my mind with skateboarding. It sort of helps focus the mind. I tried to do 180s. I did 90 degree turns. I did a few 180s. I'm still losing my balance. It's very dangerous. I was doing what I found was this hard dirt path. And I could do it on that, and the skateboard wouldn't shoot out from underneath me. If you get on a really slick, fast surface, that skateboard takes off from you so fast. You know, it is dangerous. So it focuses your mind. Realize, hey, you got to get it right. You just can't be spacing out and saying, yeah, I've been thinking about a television show. I'm thinking about the baseball games. I'm thinking about this. And oh, let me just jump on a board. It doesn't work that way. I know the super skaters make it look easy. It is not easy. It is, just getting on a board. Actually, the most dangerous thing you can do is to just stand up on a stationary board, because if your balance shifts, the board suddenly will shoot out from underneath you. It's easier to be moving because you have momentum and you're going, the board's going in a certain direction, so you know which direction it's going in. Whereas you're just standing on a stationary board, if you shift your weight, it could go either forward or backwards on you. But if the skateboard is moving forward with momentum, then it's way more stable, actually. That's why freestyle tricks are so difficult. I don't know how they do it, actually. So momentum is super important. Momentum helps us. Momentum helps us. So we want to keep the momentum of the spiritual path going. We want to keep it going. Every day practice keeps this momentum going for us. And we just have to grind it out. This is what my friend was telling me today. He says, everyday practice. He was saying exactly what I've been saying. He didn't know that I'd make these videos or anything. He doesn't know what I think, but he was telling me exactly what I've been saying. Everyday practice, you have to do it. Those who succeed, don't make any excuses. Everyone has this 24 hours in a day. You have to make the time to succeed. And he said, you know, most of the world, they don't do that. They don't do that, which is true, because they're trusting in the ego's religion, which is the religion actually of despair. They're really worshiping despair, idolatry. Everything they do just brings despair upon the mind, or at least upon the false mind. We interpret what's happening to the false mind as despair, the imaginary mind. So there's imaginary mind having imaginary despair. Illusions are subject to other illusions. And if we believe illusions are true, we will believe that these illusions are happening to us, even though they're not really happening to us. They've never touched us at all. So we have to grind it out every day. This is what we do here. Otherwise, the other option is horrible, is we get into the yellow jacket despair trap. And people just, you know, they just say, how can I get what I want in the world? And young people, they go on their energy and their looks, right? And they help my good looks, my beauty, my attractiveness, my energy, all this is going to get me what I want from this world, and then I'm going to be happy. Well, this is a disaster. And fortunately for me, I got so sick when I was young, I couldn't get anything. And so I said, the only thing I could get is the truth. I said, I've completely fell behind everybody. Never catch up. And so I said, I better get free of this world, because that's the only option I have. So I was very fortunate in that regard. And I've talked to others who also were very ill. I was like, felt very ill during my teenage years and never recovered. You lose all your momentum towards material success, was what happened. Had to drop out of college. I couldn't focus in school anymore, and just couldn't work. And so what did I do? I studied A Course in Miracles and paid attention to non-dual teaching, and said, this is what I have to do. This is what I have to do. Couldn't trade in on my looks and my energy and all this stuff that most of us do in some way. Just everything that we, all the momentum that materiality has, I couldn't use it. I could not use it. So all I could do was focus my attention. I still had control of my attention to where I could put my attention. And so I put it on, you know, the best teaching I could find. And this is what we continue to do. Put your attention on the best teaching you can find every day, and continuously wow your success. I had tremendous success today, and it's every day's this way. This friend I was talking with said, you got to watch this video. And I said, who's that? What? Well, you got to. He was very insistent. He bought a smartphone. He brought it up. I watched a little bit, and I said, wow, that's amazing. And so I went home and I watched it. I saw it was actually another one by the same videographer and skateboarder, and it was amazing. It's called Sirocco, searching S-I-R-O-C-C-O, searching Sirocco. What a video that was. It's like 6 minutes or something. It's such a mind blower. It's so beautifully done. It is just one of the best videos I've ever seen. And most of the day I was kind of just in this like spiritual daze almost. It's really something. So here we go into Labor Day. And this next stretch of 4 months, September, October, November, December. And you could say the next 6 months, but let's just take it a little, you know, the end of this year. This 4 month stretch is, you know, make or break stretch, make or break. And most people will be broken by it, to be honest. Most of us will be broken by it if there isn't some intervention of some sort. Most are already broken. You know, they're broken in. They're like horses that are broken in. They're thoroughly broken in. And they do what the ruling classes want them to do. The ego really doing what the ego wants them to do. Actually, it's the ego. Don't blame the Illuminati, the ruling class. No, it's the ego, which is our own arrogance, which is really our belief in our attempt to change what we are. Okay, this is what Jesus told us, and go to the bank on this. That all of existence is an attempt to change what we are. What we call existence, time, space, process, and form, energy, the sun, energy, all this. This is an attempt to change what we are, and we cannot change what we are. We're an idea in the mind of God, and what God creates, God never changes. Once there's an idea in the mind of God, that idea is eternal. We cannot change what we are, but we're making this vast horizontal attempt to change what we are. Now when we go vertical, we realize it's completely flat, completely flat, completely flat. This realization, you will see glimpses of it. And we're having glimpses of all this. I've had reports from those that say, hey, I just had this amazing experience. So experiences are happening. So there is, some have some spiritual momentum. They do, which is great. But this existence is an attempt to change what we are. Plain and simple, say that this existence is an attempt to change what we are. That's what it is. So why keep struggling against denying that? Say no. We can change it a little bit. We can, you know, tweak it here and there and spin it and put different labels. And no. As Sargadatta Maharaj says, don't try to conform to the mind to what's beyond it. Don't try to conform the ego to what's beyond it. Don't try to conform lies to truth. Don't try to conform lies to truth. Don't try to conform lies to truth. Don't try to conform existence to reality. When we see clearly, we realize there's never been any existence. Existence has never existed. Okay, existence has never existed. There's never been any existence. This is the real truth. This is what you don't hear enough in this world. The Dharma kings speak up on this. The Dharma assistant student teachers like myself, Dharma princes, we say it. But there's some that say this and also say the opposite and say, but we can make existence better. So, no, how can you make what's never existed? How can you make nothing better? How can we make nothing better? How can we make nothing better? Now, it's going to be a shocker because so many of us, and I don't exclude myself, who knows if we'll run and hide, you know, when some help arrives. Who knows, right? And that might be quite shocking. You might have all your friends, you might find out that they actually are dualists and they actually believe in existence and they're not ready to stop believing in it. And on the other hand, though, there might be some that come out of the woodwork that you never even knew. And it's just like, wow, these wonderful practicers and non-dualists who've been just silently, quietly going about their business may suddenly emerge out of the woodwork, and that'll be great. So there is this calling out, so to speak, the harvest time. It's harvest time. I believe it's going to start. September 6th, it's time to start the harvest. This is what I got today. It's time to start this harvest of who's really willing to see that there's never been any existence. Existence has never existed. And, you know, it's somewhat dismaying to, if your friends, your people you thought highly of, turn out to be closet dualists who are just working for the yoga girls. Probably a lot of that, actually. Just working for materialistic spiritualism as a front because they could say good non-dual terminology, etc. And yet they're really firmly in the grasp of the goddess. Which, you know, the goddess is the goddess of existence. Goddess means existence. Time, space, process, and form. That's the symbol that's used for existence. The anthropological symbol is the goddess. There's no existence. There's no goddess, and there's no existence at all. Never have been, and never will be. There's just the formless isness God of perfect freedom. So again, I don't exclude myself from this. I keep working at it. I keep working at it, but I can feel this sort of dismay, like, oh gosh, you know. You're also a closet dualist, you closet goddess worshiper. There's many closet goddess worshippers, many. I can usually see it. And what can you do? You just pray that they, you know, it's not easy to wake up to this. I understand that. It's a phase that you go through, but you got to get out of that phase. You can't be fixated in it. Don't think that by, you know, worshiping the goddess, your despair is going to go away. In fact, it's going to get a lot worse. But of course, the ego advises scapegoating. So the ego says, don't worry, I have the answer for that. What is the answer? Scapegoating. So what happens is you turn into a hater. But it's a righteous hater. You turn into a righteous hater. And then once all that hate gets a hold of you, you then channel all that into all sorts of expectations of how you want the world and everything to be. And at that point, then, truth seems extremely threatening. Extremely threatening. And reality seems like a total abyss. Because reality is completely unstructured. Complete freedom. And those who hate tend to be driven towards structuring their scapegoating. Scapegoating others. You know, controlling, regulating, everything. And so that creates this massive black hole of darkness, of fear, because when you glimpse freedom, completely changes all expectations. And the more expectations you have for the future, the more frightened you will be of truth. This is why Jesus says, don't make any plans. And this is how I've lived my life. I don't make any plans. I try not to make any plans for the future. And whenever I do, I feel very nervous. I don't like it at all. I hate it. I hate meetings. I hate this. I hate that. And meaning, I hate it not in terms of hating somebody, but I hate where it's trying to take me, which is fearing truth, fearing reality. So in a materialistic society, it's all based on future planning. It's extremely based on that. Where in more other cultures that are not so materialistic, it's you do in the now. You know, you relate with people right in the now. You're not saying, okay, I will meet you for lunch next week. I don't have any appointment calendars at all. I don't put down dates for this. I don't pay attention to birthdays. I don't pay attention to anything. I don't plan my future at all, actually. Which means I don't fit into a materialistic society at all. And they say, well, you're a failure. Well, I'm a failure at materialism, thank God. That's the one thing you want to be a failure at. That is for sure. But be a success at freedom. Be a success at freedom. And I know we, you know, we're all thinking that this world's giving us a great excuse right now. Well, there are no excuses. But what we have to do is essential. It's essential. We have to let go of trying to change what we are. And we never did change what we are, so what is there to let go of? Is nothing at all, right? So we have to let go of the belief that nothing is something. That's all. Just let go of the belief that nothing is something. Just let go of the belief that something is nothing. All of existence is just the belief that something is nothing. Or that nothing is something. It's the belief that nothing is something. Existence is the belief that nothing is something. So we just have to let go of the belief that nothing is something. Nothing is nothing. There isn't any world. There is no existence. There are no people, bodies, time, space, process, and form. All of this is then. So what is this? It's decoration, ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. This is all that it is. That's all that it is. Already, it's all inherently, spontaneously released in the now. Spontaneously, already, one with inherent spaciousness. Nothing needs to happen for everything to be one with inherent spaciousness. It's already that way. It always has been. There's never been any process to make it that way. There's never been any time to make it that way. There's never been any curing process to make it that way. There's never been anything happen to make it that way. There's never been any decoration, ornamentation that made it that way. So right now, getting traction is just not happening for me as far as getting traction in it's but we'll see what can happen, right? We'll see. I believe it might be a case where we feel like, yeah, we want to get out of prison, but we want to really succeed. We don't want to get tracked down again. You know, if we feel that we're going to be tracked down again, might as well not even do it. So everyone's waiting for something so profound. They want Jesus to come back and start walking on water. But I guarantee you, if Jesus did that, nobody would pay attention, or it wouldn't be helpful at all if he was walking on water. That wouldn't work. So we have to rely on the Holy Spirit to somehow orchestrate our freedom in spite of our reticence. The Holy Spirit will do so for those who want it. But it will never, I don't believe it will appear in some way that the ego can relate to it. Because the ego is so vicious, wanting to trap all of us into despair. That it wants to know, well, it's great, how did you get free? Where is the structure to it? I say there's no structure to it. Well, there has to be. It's the Holy Spirit. It has no structure to it. It's just all spontaneous in the now. And the ego said, well, that won't help anybody. Well, sure, it helped us. We got free. That's the way you have to do it, actually. It doesn't seem that organized religion, structured stuff, it works, does it? It really doesn't seem that way. Especially now. So the skateboarding thing I'm doing is amazing, the parallels. I'm able to draw parallels no matter what I'm doing. And if you're having success, it's the same way. No matter, everyone you meet is helpful to you, and everything you see, you see parallels. Oh, this helps, reminds me. Oh, that reminds me of full stop. Oh, that reminds me of this. And I'm trying to figure out how to practice without hurting myself. That's the problem with skateboarding, isn't it? I'm trying to come up, slow the wheels down. Some sort of hard packed dirt is how I need to do it. So I'll be able to do this. We have some hard packed dirt here. So like when you're skating along in a straight line, you're going forward, you have momentum. Now, one of the tricks that skateboarders do is they do a quick 180 like this. So now, before they were going forward facing to the right, you might say to the right, this way, and then they do a quick 180, and now they're facing this way, but they're still going in the same direction. But you have to do it real fast, real fast. So it's not like you're reversing direction, doing a 180 and reversing direction. Now that'll throw you off the board. You have to do a real quick spin, 180 spin on your board. Just reverse the front and back of the board real quickly. But I believe in order to do these tricks, you need the small wheels. I don't have those because there's less friction. They slide better. The bigger, thicker wheels, I believe it's harder to do these type of tricks, but it probably can do it. But because they grip more, it's not so easy to, when you push it, not easy to make a quick slide like that. We'll see. It's the same way of the spiritual path. We're going along like this, and the shift we need to make is a quick shift, is a real boom like that. And we're still traveling in the same direction, but we have a different viewpoint like that. So the ego will never understand how to get free from this despair trap. The ego will never understand. And the ego says, if you just teach me, then I can teach everybody else because everyone trusts me. Well, you can never teach the ego how to get free. So it doesn't work that way. It'll never work that way. But the ego, makes this bargain, wants to make this bargain and say, look, just teach me about enlightenment. Show me what kind of structure you need, how to do it. And then I'll teach everyone else and everyone will be enlightened. And this is the trap that we get deceived in, is thinking, yeah, if I just could get the ego to understand enlightenment, it cannot. It cannot. The ego inherently believes in time, space, process, and form, and despair, and that we can change what we are, and that there's a world, and that there's existence. Because that is the egoic belief. I mean, that's the belief system. So you can't teach a belief system, some other belief system. This is what Nisargadatta Maharaj was getting at. You cannot conform the mind to what is transcendent of the mind, beyond the mind. Meaning, mind, he's using the small m, meaning the ego. You cannot teach lies truth. Because lies will try to hold on and say, this is my identity. The ego says, well, my identity is time, space, process, and form. So I want to know how to fit reality into time, space, process, and form, or how to fit time, space, process, and form into reality. And the answer is there's never been any time, space, and process, and form. So how can you fit nothing into something? This is essentially what the ego is saying. We have to fit nothing into something, into everything. How do you fit nothing into everything? It's absurd. It only at the levels of concepts and words and thinking does that even seem remotely possible. But from the standpoint of truth, it's not. It's a completely absurd. There's no possibility of it. So really the ego's position is absolutely absurdist. From top to bottom, absolutely absurdist. Now, I did something, the Holy Spirit was pushing me to do something. Taking care of an elder, the Holy Spirit's one thing happens when there's some really shocking events take place. You can feel very unstable, wobbly, and fatigued. And this will especially affect the older people emotionally if they're really tied into politics and tied into what's going on politically and in believing in the world and existence. When things get really scrambled, that this can have devastating effects on everybody. And we become clumsy and uncoordinated. We start having accidents and stuff like that. You're right. When you really are shocked badly. And you don't practice full stop in the wow, you don't recognize it, you end up starting to have accidents. So what the Holy Spirit was pressing me to do is get corner cushions for all the furniture in the house, all the sharp edged, cabinets, so many sharp edges everywhere. And if I was able to get them and put them on these really nice cushiony bumpers, Yeah, because I said, you know what? People could have a fall, older people especially. What's coming up the next 2 months? Again, I don't have any specific information at all, except the Holy Spirit just is intimated that don't be surprised if there's some surprises, okay? And it may not be to the liking of a lot of people, and they might get very unstable on their feet. And if you have somebody who's just barely tottering anyway, barely, and you add severe emotional shock and the expectations of their future just become completely obliterated, they're going to fall. So I was this emergency. I put corners on. I said, I have to get these corners on right away, which I did. Very good ones. The first ones we got were terrible. They photoshopped the picture of them to make them look they're real big and they're real longer than wide and everything. And I got them and like the three sides were the size of a nickel. I mean, they were a complete joke. We returned them, and then the ones I got now are fabulous. Really, really great. They're effective. If you fall down, hit your head on a corner or something, these will save your life, actually. They really will. I mean, you'll get a bruise if you fall, but if you hit a sharp corner, that for an older person, that may be the end of it. These are like practical things that I'm doing because I expect the next several months and really leading up to inauguration and all of, is whatever happens in the United States, there is going to be a feeling of instability in the country. Very, very much so. It's not going to be settled at all. And people putting their faith in that situation, it could be in for some devastating blows, actually. So, you see, the Holy Spirit said, "Look, that's just a nice pragmatic state. Isn't that brilliant? That it dropped my attention to this whole issue of stability and older people falling and then realizing I looked around and said, oh my gosh, there's sharp corners everywhere. If you're gonna fall, there's like about a high chance you're gonna hit your head on one of these very sharp furniture corners. So now they're all cushioned, beautifully cushioned, and just a proactive move. Proactive move, it gives a sense of okay, at least I'm doing something. At least I'm preparing in some way. Now, diet-wise, I'm very much into fruit juice. Like tonight, I had organic strawberries, a papaya, and a whole bunch of blueberries and tart cherry juice, and just juiced that up. And I drank that, and I actually had a little bit of solid meal, which I'm not doing so much of anymore. A little bit, just a green leaf lettuce. What did I put in there? A little bit of feta cheese and a hard boiled egg and some cottage cheese. Hard boiled egg, cottage cheese, and some lettuce. So that's not a bad dinner, right? But I'm really going more and more to fresh juice. Blend up a papaya, a banana, an apple. Oh, I put an apple in it also. An apple, strawberry, papaya, and blueberries and cherry juice. So that's and just going with that. And a lot of water. So these are, stringent measures, but if we don't take stringent measures in our life right now, when do we expect to take them? After turmoil breaks out, that's no time to apply stringent measures. It's being proactive. That is, stringent measures are designed to be proactive. That's why we call them stringent. If something actually already happens and you take, take measures, then you say, well, I just necessity had to do it. But you don't think it's so stringent. But when you do it ahead of time, it does seem stringent. Like you're really, do I really have to do this? And maybe everything will be fine. And no. Don't rely on this in this world, which is the whole design is to produce despair, total despair in us. Don't believe that things are going to be fine. Now, I know that people quote Jesus in ACIM saying, imagine the world, just a world where God takes care of everything. Everything's gentle for you, and isn't this great? And people think, oh yeah, this world exists. Now Jesus is talking about the real world. He's not talking about existence, this world. He's talking about the real world, which is not a world at all, actually. It's an illusion, a healed dream type of situation. But the purpose of the ego is despair. You can't change the ego. You cannot change. It's because it's an idea that we had, a silly notion of to change what we are. So you can't have that idea and change that idea, because that would be changing what we are. You understand this? We have ideas, just like God has ideas. Every idea, you cannot change that idea. So we have this idea of changing what we are. You can't change that idea. You can choose another idea, sure. We're free to choose another idea, because this idea of changing what we are is just nothing. That's all it is, nothing at all. How do you experience nothing? There's nothing there to experience. But so you can't change that idea. You have to choose another idea. So you cannot change the idea of changing what we are, because if we did, that would just prove we could change what we are. In other words, we can have an idea and change that idea, different effects from that idea. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to change what the effects we're experiencing from what we are. We want to change what we are, meaning our experiencing, the way that God created us, trying to change that. So by claiming we can change the ego, that's exactly what the ego wants us to do, is try to change the ego. And that would change what we are. Instead, we do nothing at all to the ego. We just choose a different idea. This is what non-duality really is. This is Sagarada Maharaj saying that. Tonight I saw a post that was very nice. Don't try to conform the mind to what's beyond the mind, to what's true. Don't try to conform the ego to truth at all. That is the mistake we make. So don't try to change this world. Don't try to change this world of despair at all. Just choose to see the real world, which is, Jesus used this term as real world, but really it's no world at all, no existence at all. Is just beautiful creative ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. See that. The healed mind, as he calls it. He applies positive terms to it, though, so we can relate to it. And reaching down to help us. We're not fixated on those terms. Don't see a healed ego. An ego that would be changing the idea. The idea of trying to change what we are. Don't see that idea healed. Choose another idea. The idea of not trying to change what we are. Therefore, what we experience, we have no desire to try and change it. Because it's blissful. There's no despair. When you're in despair, you're trying to change it, right? So we think that if we just get a deep enough despair, we'll be able to change the ego. This is not true. This is not true. Pretty clever trap, huh? So we think despair is transformative, meaning we'll just be in such hideous despair that will motivate us to finally change this idea. Not to choose another idea, but to actually modify the idea, modify the effects of this idea. This is the delusion of the ego. This is insanity. Trying to modify the effects of an idea is what does not work, what can never work. Beautiful day today, gorgeous day. I don't know what kind of season it is. It's a new season. It's a fifth season in California. I'm liking it. Extraordinarily temperate and kindly. The atmosphere feels very kindly, actually. Maybe it knows something's bad's coming and the world's helping us out. California's helping us out. I wouldn't doubt it. Nature will help us out when we see it in a grace type of way. After all, it's a reflection of our thinking. This is not modifying the effects of the idea necessarily. Okay. I know it's easy to confuse this, but the grace of God does echo. It does echo. It's an echo. It's not a change of this idea of despair, but it's echoing off of this idea. The Holy Spirit's able to like echo off of this idea we have. And if we just pay attention to the echoing, this is what Jesus calls the real world, the echoing of the Holy Spirit. So this beautiful atmosphere of California now, this may be the echoing of the Holy Spirit. So just, you know, pay attention to that, to the essence of it. And this turns our attention towards choosing a new idea. Okay, it turns our attention. So the Holy Spirit, remember, plays with attention. And again, so this is an attention getter. It's an echo, like an attention getter. Where, like, hey, I don't feel like I need to change anything at all about the weather here. I don't feel despair about the weather at all here. And this gets us ready for the real world, for reduced intensity zone, where we look at the world, we feel like, I don't really feel like I need to change anything at all. Everything is just great, just the way it is. And then, of course, that does not generate despair, does it? And that does not generate an attempt to try and change an idea, the effects of an idea. Because in reality, you cannot change the effects of an idea. You have to choose a different idea. If you want a different experiencing, choose a different idea. That's reality. And so we're fixated on no, we got to keep this one idea, but let's change the effects of it all over the place. That's not how reality functions. Cause and effect. An idea has its effects. If you want to experience something different, you choose a different idea. You don't try to modify the effects. But we're so into trying to modify effects that the Holy Spirit, the way it works, it will like echo. It's like, Ricola, and it bounces off a cliff, and you hear, what's that? And you think it's coming from the cliff, right? But it's not. It's coming from the Holy Spirit. It's an echo. So maybe this weather is like an echo of the Holy Spirit. It's very unusual. It feels very fallish. It's like an early fall. So early that there's a coolness and a crispness to the air mixed with the warmth, kind of blended all together. Spring, summer, fall. Kind of feel to it all. Spring, summer, fall, feel to it all. Spring, summer, fall, kind of feel to it all here. And The key thing is that though that the Holy Spirit can echo off of any situation here, and who knows, maybe I'm just feeling the echo, maybe others are not feeling the same way I'm feeling. Well, that really everyone I meet, it seems like the Holy Spirit's echoing off of them. It's really true. It's astonishing. I don't know what to make of it, but it's just astonishing. This friend of mine, I see him occasionally, and we were talking about skateboarding, and he's a skater. I said, "Oh wow, you're a skater, yeah." I found out he's also a golfer. I said, "Wow, that's amazing," and he has a similar philosophy to mine. I said, "Wow, that's amazing," but he insisted. Wait. Oh yeah, you know this guy? You ever heard of this guy? I got to show you, and he insisted on it. Really spent time to make sure I saw it, and then I was just like, "Wow, that is really." It's a way, you know, the Holy Spirit has ways of echoing to us. The echoes of reality here. Faint echoes, yes. But faint is even faint is enough to, you know, like a scent, love the scent, even just the faintest little touch of the scent is enough to suddenly wake up your interest in it, right? Because you really love it so much and you've forgotten the scent. Haven't you experienced this, that some point in your life you've had to smell some scent of something, and you said, oh, that's, I just love that scent. And maybe it's been 20 years since you smelled it, or 30, 40 years, or something like that. I remember, like, for me, plumeria blossoms in Hawaii, and it was like 30 years or 40 years until I smelled it again. I said, I smelled it again. Oh, it just brought back. It was just a little scent. If you love it, just a little scent is enough to sort of light a fire in you. So the Holy Spirit gives these little echoes of reality here somehow. And that's enough to awaken the desire in us to choose a different idea instead of despair. Yeah, we've been very clever with despair, clever trap. But so what? Again, it's trying to make something out of nothing. And all we could do is just be clever. You know, it's really not creative at all, is it? Not really. The ornamentation is an expression of our creativity, but the strategy is not really creative at all. Not really. It's just, it's clever. It's innovative. It's clever. It's ingenious. But it's absurd, actually. It's just, how can we camouflage absurdity? Yeah, but what is that? Is that really creativity? How do we camouflage absurdity? That's not what we really created. Our creativity was not really meant for that. How do we camouflage absurdity? How do we camouflage absurdity? Yeah. Okay. How are we doing here? Well, great, as always. Very tired. It's a real stressful week in every which way. As we're going in towards Labor Day, the United States is Labor Day. Sunday, Monday's the 5th, that's Labor Day. And it's meeting everybody back from vacations, everybody back to work. It means everybody's attention is now going to be on the election. And you see, when you're on vacation during the summer, maybe you've got your mind elsewhere, and you're thinking about your vacation, what you're going to do. Now it's back to the grind, back to money, back to business, back to politics, back to this, back to, you know. This is when the trouble is likely to rise. Everybody has their attention off vacation. Well, I never have my attention off vacation. Permanent vacation. It's amazing as we accumulate expectations, how much more difficult it is to learn stuff like skateboarding. It's so difficult. When you're young, I can just practice for hours and hours and hours doing the same thing and not feel so tired at all. Probably I felt tired, but the energy overcame it. Because I didn't have so many expectations, so there's not so much psychological stress. Now, just a little bit of practicing, I feel so tired. I said, physically, I can't possibly be tired physically. I'm in great shape. So it's very, the Holy Spirit is amazing. It wanted me to get in great shape, which I am in great shape. So I could see just how powerful the mind is in terms of the stress making you feel tired. I said, physically, if you're in such great shape and you get tired like that, it has to be the mind, doesn't it? Sure it does. Has to be. I said, this is ridiculous. I should be able, it's like I can run up 1,500 stairs. And run down 1,500 stairs, and yet sometimes I feel so tired. It's like I feel like going up 10 stairs is too much. I say, how is that possible? That's really weird, isn't it? It's a mental condition that we're talking about. It's a mental condition. Has to be. So then we stop thinking about the body. The body can't be the problem. It has to be the mind. You see the Holy Spirit getting you in shape. You realize the body can't be the problem. It has to be the mind. And then you can focus in on the mind, and it's instead of focusing on the body. So when the troubles come in this world, the materialist will have you focus on the body, saying, well, there's something wrong with the body. But for me, I'm in such good shape, I will focus on the mind. I'll say, no, it can't be the body. It has to be the mind. I'm in great shape. So if I'm feeling exhausted, it's the mind that's exhausted, not the body. I'm not exhaling. I'm exhausted. It's like I'm. You see these people in more, indigenous third world people that don't have so much stress. The endurance they have is mind blowing. A mind that is relaxed. The body just has this amazing endurance, but in the stressful situation, pressure cooker I'm in Silicon Valley, I get fatigued so easily just doing a few little things, because the mental pressure here is just crazy. But I know, I said, wait a minute, I just worked out so like this so amazingly. It cannot be. My body, it cannot be that. It's like, do I lack the muscles to do this? No. But I feel so tired, I can hardly lift this. I say, how is it possible I can hardly lift this? I had to lift a water bottle. It's like, oh, I can barely do it. I say, wait a minute. I'm so strong, physically strong, and yet I feel feeble. Isn't that feebleness in the mind? It has to be. And what causes that? Well, extreme wow, unacknowledged, undissipated, that we're trying to change the ego, we're trying to change the world. This is what causes the fatigue, mental fatigue. And that is the ego. Trying to change the world is the ego. Trying to change the ego is the ego. When you ask, what was the definition of ego? The attempt to change the ego, that's the ego. The attempt to get rid of the ego, to change it, that's the ego. That's the trick. It's a temptation. Jesus said, get away from me. You know, they're trying to tempt you to do miracles, change the world. Get away from me, Satan, Jesus said. That is the ego. This is what most are missing. Most are missing this. But when they hear it, they say, yeah, that's great. But there's always, they have something in their back pocket like, yeah, but I've got this super yoga girl. She can change my world. She can change my world for the better. That kind of thing. Or I've got some super yoga guy. He can change my world for the better. Not true. Not true at all. This completely avoids non-duality. Totally sweeps it aside. That which we're already enlightened. Nothing needs to be changed. Except the idea. Choose a different idea. Now, is it absurd to have the idea that we're already where we are? Yeah, but that's okay. One absurd idea deserves another. So this is the way we counter and smooth out our continuity fear. Because I have the idea of not trying to leave reality, not trying to change what I am. Now, that's pretty absurd, right? If we can't change what we are, why would we have an idea of that of not changing what we are? To have an intermediate step back to just not even the notion of changing who we are doesn't even arise at all. Absurdity doesn't even come into play at all. But we're so used to absurdity, we need to counter absurdity and at least still keep some absurdity there. It's kind of absurd to say, well, I'm already, the idea of being already home. Well, if we're already home, why do we need an idea of it? Right? So at that level, it's still absurd. As Jesus said, it's still an illusion. It's the illusion that frees us from all illusion, though. It's the absurdity that frees us from all absurdity. I like that term absurdity better than illusion. Illusion really doesn't conjure up anything for me. But absurdity most certainly does, because our mind has been working. We can see our mind works in such absurdist ways. The reasoning, the logic we're using is so absurd. So it's the absurdity that helps free us from all absurdity. And Jesus never said, "You must use the words that I use." He never said that. So if I find a word that I feel has had a stronger bite to it and can really latch onto it, then I use it. Holy Spirit probably suggests it. And you know, in your case, where you're at now, why don't you use the term absurdity? It's a great way to use it. You think about words, you have to use some words. I mean, so Jesus had to choose his words. He had to use words, some words, where we were at to get us started. But you know, once you get started, once you get momentum, then maybe you can use some other words. Of course you can. Like a skateboard, you got to get skating. You got to start pushing. If you're just trying to stand on it and not go anywhere, you're going to feel like, if I'm, you know, I'm in danger. It's very dangerous. Once you got momentum in a certain direction, you're much less dangerous. So then once you've got momentum going, then you can start working it. Right, you can start carving it and working it. And you may come up with some tricks, and you can do all sorts of stuff that you can't really do very well when you're just standing still. So Jesus had to take us. We were standing still. We were at a standstill. He had to take us and get us going. So he chose words to get us going. A Course in Miracles really is a course in getting us going, getting us out of a standstill. A course in momentum really is what it really is. I know he says miracles, but I'll say a course in momentum. It really is a course in momentum. Once you get that momentum going, then, you know, there's so much stuff, like a skateboarder. He's going fast, he's got momentum. Guess what? He can jump stairs, he can jump rails, he can hop ledges. They can do all these tricks because they got momentum going. So, a course in momentum. I took a course in momentum. And we choose the absurdity that frees us from all absurdity. The absurdity of the idea of that I'm already home. Of course, if I'm already home, why would I need an idea? That's the absurdity of it. But it serves a purpose, because we're so accustomed to absurdity that without at least a faint whiff of absurdity, we might freak out, mentally freak out. So, relax. You'll still have some absurdity. We still have some absurdity. So I worry very much about people who are politically engaged. I really do. And what can I do? I've spent my life trying to help them. I've gotten nowhere. You know, I've spent my life trying to help people get unfixated. I've gotten nowhere. That's how severe the fixation is. Ignorance is not bliss, it's fixation. And fixation is a setup for despair. When you put all your eggs in the basket of time, space, process, and form, and the purpose of which is to cause you despair, guess what? You're going to suffer despair. Put all your eggs in the basket, and suddenly the basket fails, and the eggs drop, and all break. Right? Bottom falls out of that basket. You're in trouble. So, but the thing is that the ego teaches us all that despair is salvation. Because the ego, its purpose is to change what we are. So from the standpoint of the ego, I mean, the ego says our happiness, it really means its happiness. The happiness of nothing depends on us changing what we are into nothing. Trying to change everything into nothing. So we feel that we need to keep fixating so the despair can hit us. Fixate, special relationship, despair, politics, despair is a setup for despair. Absolutely it is. So don't fixate on politicians. Don't fixate on anything that isn't truly non-dual. Okay, it's that simple. And even in the non-dual, don't over-fixate on anything in particular. Certainly pay close attention and let it sink in. keep your 360 degreeness and your own integral, you know, inherent spaciousness and your relationship with the Holy Spirit. Keep that foremost. It's like the world is like skating down a really steep concrete hill, and really steep, and they're just like going a million miles an hour. They're still on the board, but they're looking ahead, and there's all these obstacles, all these cars, a street's coming up, you know, light posts, bench. It's like I'm going like 50 miles an hour. How do I stop? I'm on a skateboard. How do I stop? You don't want to get going too fast on a skateboard like that down a hill. How are you going to stop? Well, you're gonna, you know, this is a question, isn't it? Now, what if we were going down this sidewalk, a street, and we got going so fast, we can't make any turns at all. We're going too fast. There's obstacles everywhere. We're in this straight linear line going too fast. We've already lost it in terms of speed. We should have braked long before, but we're going too fast. Well, what can save us? A hill, coming upon a hill can save us, right? So if you're going down like this, down, it's real steep, 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 like this, going too fast. If you came upon a hill that went up like that, you go, ooh, start going up the hill, that would automatically slow you down, wouldn't it? So some sort of hill would slow us down. Or a grassy hill that you could turn and go up this grassy hill, and maybe you tumble and fall a little bit on the grass. But we got to get off the concrete. We got to get to the side somehow. Maybe there's a side hill we can, like, turn a little bit and start going up the side hill, and that'll just naturally slow us down, because the world is going too fast. They're like someone on a skateboard going a million miles an hour down this concrete, slippery concrete, like a face of a reservoir, Hoover Dam, like we're skating down Hoover Dam. Imagine if we're skating the face of Hoover Dam. Imagine you're on a skateboard and you're skating down the face of Hoover Dam. And you're looking down, and there's nothing but, you know, a couple thousand feet or whatever, I don't know how it's of concrete in front of you, straight down. How are you going to stop? Right? What if a ramp suddenly appeared right in front of you? You saw it Hoover Dam. There's a ramp in front of you, and so you took the ramp. The ramp kind of goes straight for a while, still going fast, and then starts going up gradual uphill slope like that, and just naturally slows you down gradually, just like, oh my gosh, because pretty much we're going so fast in the wrong direction now, downhill, down the face of Hoover Dam, that it's hard to go to you know, change. Like turn to a side. So it almost has to be something like straight ahead of us. When just a sort of a ramp that somehow it may start as going down, but not so severe. So it's not such a severe slope. And then it starts to level out pretty quickly, and then it starts to go up. But we could stay on our board if we keep going straight. But trying to turn, it might be too much of a problem. So there has to be something like a ramp that appears for us. And it may still seem to be going downhill, but it is much gentler downhill. And so we start slowing down just by going down a gentler slope. And then it starts to level off. We slow down that way, and then we start to go up a little gently up, and that slows us down too. That's the only thing that will save us right now in the world, is this ramp. Some sort of gentle ramp. We thought that skating down the face of Hoover Dam would be really cool. Why? Because it would generate massive despair. As you're skating down, you say, wow, this is cool. I'm really going fast. Now I'm going like about 100 miles an hour. And but I've got still 1,000 feet of concrete to go. And it's just like the slope is, 70-degree slope or something. And you're starting to realize at some point, you start to say, hey, I don't think this is going to work out well. How do I slow down? I don't see any way to slow down. And it generates this massive, sudden despair. So it's the world is like, there's a good analogy for the world. When you're on sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you don't realize, you think, hey, this is cool. This is fun. I'm skating down Hoover Dam. I'm going so fast. Wow, this is radical, I'm being real sleazy and radical. And no shame, I got no shame. Isn't this cool? Let's just be raunchy, no shame and all this. And so it's like, initially you think, wow, I'm really a daredevil. I'm really cool. I'm being avant-garde. I'm really, this happens over and over in the world. And so you get into this and then at some point you look and say, oh my gosh, what have I done? There's no way to slow down. And that's, then there's a sort of a period of confusion like, there must be a way to slow down. No, I don't see any. What am I doing? What happened? Am I really doing this? And then it hits you, wow, I really did. And then you despair, you realize, oh my gosh, I'm toast. There's no way to slow down. There's no apparent way to slow down. Then suddenly the despair hits. Suddenly the despair hits. Suddenly. Suddenly. So this is why it's so difficult to assess trends in the world. If you really have to be wise about it. You have to understand that the despair doesn't hit initially if you were skating down the face of Hoover Dam, because you're in an intoxicated, delirious kind of state, materialistic state, like that, hey, the ego told me that if I did this, I'd be super cool, and here I go, wow. It does, a wise person would look and say, oh, okay, obviously despair is going to hit you, but it doesn't hit right away. And it doesn't even hit in the middle part, because they still keep thinking like, I'm so cool that everything should be fine. And they say, wait a minute, but, so you're more in the but mode. But, thinking all sorts of, thoughts like, oh my gosh, maybe my thoughts can heal it. And then it's like, no, oh my gosh. Despair, boom. So despair in such a situation, you would generally say it hits all at once. It hits very rapidly. And at that point, you crash off the board or something, right? You lose all stability. So you want to get on that ramp, which is the ramp of the Holy Spirit. You want to get on that ramp and that slows you down. Yeah. It's amazing how skateboarding is a great metaphor for everything that's going on. The Holy Spirit must have known this. So that's why I said you got to get into skating, and so you can really feel the metaphor. Feel it. Not just think of it, feel it. Have a real feel for it. Okay. So this is probably enough for now, because everyone's, really probably dragging at this point. It's like, wow, global despair could hit super fast, actually. This is how it usually hits. It doesn't, we've been delaying it for so long. We've been saying, no, maybe, there's got to be, I'm so cool, there's got to be, I thought everything was fine, this is so wonderfully egoic, let's just, and then we've been pushing the realization down the road. But then we look down, we still got another 1,000 feet to go, and it's just 70-degree concrete. And there's no way to stop. And finally, despair hits us. Just boom, all at once. This is what I'm concerned about. Because really, we've been kicking the can down the road. We've been denying it for so long. You know, trying, you know, just become as raunchy as we possibly can. As much sex, drugs, and rock and roll. In other words, music, pharmaceuticals, and just every kind of decadent, dissolute, sleazy, raunchiness possible. We're just trying to, what can we do with the body, you know, to make us feel better? We've been doing this now for quite some time, actually. Quite some time. You might even say 50 years, almost, right? Close to 50 years, actually. We've been desperately trying to distract ourselves from the direction of that materiality is plunging us towards, which is despair. And we're out of tricks, you know. The mind just it doesn't work anymore. Hey, let's get really wicked, you know. That didn't work. You know, hey, let's take a bunch of drugs. Oh, that doesn't work. Hey, let's just and quickly we say, hey, that doesn't work. And then we look down and say, you know, nothing works in terms of the ego. Nothing the ego has for us works at all. And then that's when panic can grip you. Sudden despair, the panic of sudden despair can happen in an instant, actually. And so you might have somebody that seems perfectly normal, but they've been trying all this stuff, hoping it works. And at some point they realize none of it works, and they don't have the Holy Spirit in their life, haven't repented, then suddenly they can just lose it. And, you know, just almost instantly, actually, and plunge into despair. Jump off their board and just said, maybe I can fly, you know, I better try flying. This is, the board isn't working. Ultimately, we could, but we don't see it that way. We're trying to change. It's like we say, well, I can't fly. I'm a body in time, space, process, form, but maybe I can get that body to fly. You know, people say, what about the bird suits and all this? That's just an example of the mentality of the ego. But I'm talking about the dynamics of the mind here, okay? And thinking that, well, we can have time, but we can, you know, not experience the effects of time. So I believe in time, but not experience the effects of it. That's not possible. That's what Jesus has pointed out to us. Did it? Jesus has done a great job. Great job. Great job. Great job, Jesus. Really highlighting what needed to be highlighted. That's the job of these great Dharma kings. They highlight what needs to be highlighted at any given, you know, era that we're going through right now. This is where we're at. We're skateboarding down Hoover Dam, the face of it, and we've tried everything, and now we realize, you know, that none of that stuff works. None of it works. So, Holy Spirit, ramp, here we come. Absolutely, Holy Spirit, ramp, here we come. And as soon as we get on that ramp, guess what? We're no longer on Hoover Dam, face of Hoover Dam. We're off of the face of Hoover Dam. Now, it may still, maybe the slope is now 50 degrees instead of 70. And then it changes to 40 degrees, and then 30 degrees, and then 20 degrees, and then 10 degrees. Then 5, and then 0, then uphill a little bit, 5 degree uphill grade, 10 degree uphill grade, 15 degree uphill grade, something like that. But we're not on the face of Hoover Dam anymore. We're on the Holy Spirit's vert ramp, you know, the ramp. and this slows us down from this to fall into despair. So don't despair. I mean, right now, realize the Holy Spirit is profoundly active. It's only superficial at the level. The Holy Spirit only seems superficial at the level of words and concepts. The Holy Spirit is actually completely profound. Totally and completely profound. totally and completely profound. The ego's trying everything right now. Throws a lot of fancy words out there, you know. Ah, fancy words. Maybe you can put the brakes on this skating, you know. That doesn't work either. It just distracts us from the Holy Spirit. The more we think that words can solve the problem, the more we're distracted from the Holy Spirit. It has a pragmatic solution, this ramp, so to speak. This other absurdity of, you know, the idea that I never left home. I never left home. Nothing ever happened. I'm already enlightened. That's an absurdist idea, because if we're already enlightened, why do we need to have an idea that we're already enlightened? Okay? But that's the ramp that helps slow us down. Okay, get it? Holy Spirit is super pragmatic. It can never be appreciated by the ego or by words. Okay, words are never sufficient. The most that words can get is to serve a lukewarm appreciation of the Holy Spirit. It's not profound. But feeling-wise, it can be profound. So we have to feel this inner feeling of the Holy Spirit, just this gratitude and trust in the Holy Spirit, that it's completely profound. Because it's completely effective. Gets the job done. That's all we need done. That's just one job. We need to slow down. Slow down all that bad momentum, false momentum, towards trying to change the effects of an idea. Choose another idea, experience the effects of those that we don't want to change those effects, and then we're back into being able to function the way God created us, which is choosing ideas and experiencing them and playing with the ideas and not trying to modify the effects of an idea. Okay? I'm meeting interesting minds now. It's pretty astonishing what's going on. Very few have faith in the Holy Spirit, I have to say this. But that is the absolute key. And of course, the Dharma Kings work for the Holy Spirit. So faith in the Holy Spirit is the absolute key. And this, do not try to formulate a faith conceptually. All right, the Holy Spirit, my faith comes from the proof the Holy Spirit's given me, pragmatic proof. Massive pragmatic proof. That's where my faith has come from. Not from my thinking about it and coming up with some rationale, thinking, well, I think the Holy Spirit is fairly profound. No, it doesn't come from that. It comes from actually so many amazing synchronicities and real recognitions that the play, the orchestration is total. It's total. So how could the Holy Spirit not orchestrate our escape from this one absurdity of trying to change what we are, and that of something, that nothing is something? How could the Holy Spirit not be able to do that? Of course it can do it can do that. So that's the very definition of profound. You don't need to go any further. You don't need to dissect it at all. If something is the very meaning of profundity, which the Holy Spirit is, it is the definition and the meaning of profundity. What other words do we need? We don't need any more, do we? We don't need any more. And so right away we're beyond words. So, I don't want to make promises down the road too much. Right now, we have to slow down this free fall into despair that we're in the world. And coming up, it could get just like that. And the sudden switch into a despair mindset, a panic mindset, can happen overnight in the world. It's like a wildfire. How long does it take for a wildfire to start? You know what? You light a match. Somebody lights a match. At night, at 3 a.m, with the strong Santa Ana winds are up, and at 10 o'clock in the morning, or whatever, there's a massive raging wildfire happening. It happens extremely fast. The same thing happens in the world when the world switches over to despair, full despair mode. The trap that they've set is effective, which is to drive them into despair. Suddenly the trap springs shut and the mindset becomes one of despair. That can happen extremely fast, maybe within a day, maybe a couple days, maybe a week. It can happen very fast, so fast that you don't even have time to adjust to it. If you don't have faith in the Holy Spirit, cannot practice full stop on the wow, then you're going to be swept away by it. So we just feel the trust in the Holy Spirit. Just decide, I'm going to trust the Holy Spirit. It knows how to slow me down. It knows I can choose another idea. It can echo, it can send echoes that I can experience and feel. And I'm just going to trust the Holy Spirit, that's all. And that's the end of the explanation, because I'm just going to put faith in that the Holy Spirit's profoundly effective. And that's all. That's all there is to it. And again, the ego is the attempt to choose the ego. So there's nothing more I need to say, because anything more would be an attempt to change the ego. And the ego says, well, educate me in this. That's an attempt to change the ego. Don't educate the ego in anything. There's a way, that's a trick. Just trust in the Holy Spirit. I may go off Facebook for a while. Actually, it's getting rather ominous. But on the other hand, I'm seeing the trap, and how cleverly it's set up, which is, helpful. Holy Spirit's just pointing that out to me. So everything I see is helpful, very helpful. Some animal's making a funny noise out there. I don't know what that is. Wow. Okay. Here we go with Labor Day weekend. Feel your trust in the Holy Spirit. Just allow the felt trust to be there. Turn your life over to the Holy Spirit. Turn your future over to the Holy Spirit, plain and simple. Just turn it over to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit play your attention and not the ego. You're not a teacher of the ego. No one's a teacher of the ego. And the Holy Spirit doesn't need to be taught. So nobody's really a teacher here at all. That's just a term we use. It's really an egoic term. There's no one to teach and nothing to teach. No teacher, no teaching, no student. This is the truth. But you could say that is a teacher, to remain still a bit absurdist, right? Right. There's nothing wrong with still staying a bit absurdist. It's pragmatically effective. So the teacher and the teaching, the student is to recognize there is no teaching, teacher, student, because there's nothing to teach. The Holy Spirit doesn't need to be taught, and the ego cannot be taught. And that's it. You either put your faith in one or the other. And the lie of the ego is that it can be taught. That's the lie. The ego says it can be taught. It cannot be taught. You cannot teach effects of an idea to be separate from the idea. You cannot teach that. So the ego cannot be taught, because that's its purpose. But there's no teaching that's going to result in that purpose being realized. So there's no realization for the ego at all. So how can there be a teacher of realization for the ego? Cannot be. It's not possible. Wow. Hour and 30 something minutes. That's nice. Oh, man. It's amazing. This friend showed me these videos of Killian Martin, K-I-L-I-A-N-M-A-R-T-E-N, I think, maybe, or I-N Martin, M-A-R-T-E-N or I-N. Killian Martin, Brett Novak, I think, is the videographer, very talented. And he turned me on to these videos. I've watched maybe four of them, and it's like they go to India, and this other one, they go all over the world. It's amazing how they do it. Skating through India, that was so amazing. It was so amazing, the backdrops they used. And these were real treats for me. And then here I have some pastries that I got croissants, really nice croissants, four of them. And I was going to give them away today. I said, who do I give these to? I thought I was going to give them to someone. And no, he left. I was going to give them to him, and he disappeared. I said, where'd he go? And I can't find him, so I couldn't give them to him. I couldn't give them to him. And so I didn't know who to give them to. And so I left this place, and I forgot something there. And suddenly I realized, oh, I have to go back there. And I was, after I left it, I watched these videos. I said, thank you. I feel full of gratitude for this my friend, for you know, bringing my attention to these videos. But I forgot something where he was, and I had to go back there. I said, wait a minute. I have these pastries, and I'm going back there. Why don't I give these treats to him for the treats he gave to me? And that's what I ultimately did. I found him. I gave him the treats, and he was very thankful. He said, oh, thank you. That's really great. Really appreciate it. Because I said, look, you gave me the treats of these videos. I'm giving you some treats in return. This is what I have. Isn't that amazing synchronicity? The Holy Spirit caused me to forget something there on purpose, so I'd go back and give him the treats. And it's just mind-blowing how it worked. It was perfect. The whole thing was just orchestrated. The Holy Spirit is just beyond any words. We cannot teach what the Holy Spirit does. We cannot teach it. It's unteachable, completely unteachable. So really the whole thing, give up teaching, give up being a teacher, give up being a student, and just put your faith in the Holy Spirit. That's all. And we could still engage in the absurdity that there's a teacher, a teaching, a student from this context, like just like the absurdist idea that I'm already free. That's still an absurdist idea. We don't need an idea that we're free. God has the idea that we're free. We don't need that idea. But so it's absurd, but it helps us pragmatically. So we could still have the absurdist idea that there's something that there's to teach, but there isn't anything to teach. So since there's nothing to teach, how could there be a student or a teacher? Right? No teaching automatically means there's no student or teacher, right? Do you get this? Do we get this here? I say you get it. I'm speaking to myself also. It's the impersonal you. It's the total you, all of us. If there's no teaching, if nothing can be taught, then how can there be a teaching? And if there's no teaching, how can there be a teacher or a student? None of those exist, do they really? Not at all. It's absurd to believe they do. But it can be a useful absurdity by the Holy Spirit to some extent. But again, if nothing can be taught, how can there be a teaching? And how can there then, if there's no teaching, how can there be a teacher or a student? Cannot be, right? Cannot be. What the Holy Spirit does cannot be taught, and the ego cannot be taught to realize its purpose of changing the effects of an idea. Since that's impossible, there can't be any teaching on how to do it. And since there can't be any teaching on how to do it, there can't be any teacher of how to do it, nor can there be any student of how to do it. No, so then there's nothing there. There's nothing there, right? There's nothing there. So this video has turned out a lot better than I thought. I was tired, I'm exhausted, uninspired, but it's just the momentum I have. I'm able to do it. I'm able to do it. I was just so surprised that we really had a great non-dual intensive here. Just seasoned, full of it. And I didn't know what to think. I didn't have any plans of, I just thought kind of like, bleh. But no, the momentum is there. The speed is there, the momentum is there. So it's all good, even though I don't feel on top of the world, I feel on the bottom. But part of it is just having my mind, just I'm getting knocked out so much, so knocked out. I'm woozy. Knocked out by the recognitions, and just this video's knocking me out. You know, the clarity just knocking me out. It's like, wow, how much clarity can we stand in one day? This is the question. Well, you know, let's see, let's find out. How much chocolate ice cream can you eat in one day? I stopped eating chocolate. As soon as I start eating chocolate, I know I'm in trouble with my diet, because I say, no, one little piece. I know exactly how it goes. I have one little piece. I say, that's okay. So I have one little piece tomorrow, the next day. That's great. Chocolate's really good. It doesn't hurt me at all. Look, my weight's fine. And then one day I said, you know what? I'm a little tired. I kind of got a sweet tooth. I'm going to have two pieces. I do that for a while. And then finally, one day, I have a whole row, four pieces in a row. I have four pieces. I just one row. I said, I just one row. It's not that much. I still am okay. Then, before too long, I said, well, one row wasn't bad. How about two rows? All right, one and a half. I'll do one and a half row, and then I'm on two rows. And then I'm on two and a half, and then I'm on three rows. And then before you know it, I'm on the entire bar of chocolate I'm eating. And I said, oh, that's not so bad. I might, you know. And then I have, you know, one and a half bars a day. Maybe two full bars a day. And in a matter of like a month's time or something, and then I'm starting to eat carbohydrates more, and I'm starting, my diet changes. And before you know it, I've gained 5 pounds. Boom! It suddenly jumps up on me like that. Happens the same way every time. Chocolate's always the way I get led down the primrose path. And so I noticed it. I said, uh-oh, here we go. So what I did was I knocked off the chocolate, knocked it out. Just stopped. I had a bar. I gave it away. Okay, I had a couple bars. Gave it away. This here. Okay. No chocolate. And then I got off the carbohydrates. Then I got back onto the juice. I got back onto the fruit. And I've dropped almost 6 pounds in under a week. I'm really dropping over a pound a day, you could say, or at least a pound a day. 29, 30, 31, 1. Today's the 2nd. So 5 days, I've lost 6 pounds, more than 6 pounds, I believe. So just about 6 pounds. Yeah, 6 pounds in 5 days. And tomorrow I may have even dropped more, possible. I feel quite hungry. So it shows us that if we have awareness of our bad habits, which we can stop them more quickly and then take immediate strong action. So being aware that this chocolate thing, I know this is the way I fail, and for sure I'm failing again. No, don't say no, it's okay this time, that's different. No, this is how I fail. Stop the failure, get off of that, get right, and I know how to succeed. Fruit juice, water. And a matter of fact, I'm going to blend. What I do is I get a smoothie and I drink half it, and then I pour water in to blend it half and half in the next half. So the next half is diluted, but I get more liquid that way. So diluting the smoothies with water half and half is brilliant. It tastes great, actually, but it lasts twice as long, right? It's really helpful. So I know how to do the right stuff, dieting. I know how bad habits, I catch them early. I know how to do the right stuff, and I'm right back on it. And wouldn't you know it, that I totally turned it around fast in the right direction. So the momentum now is really going great in that direction. So this just shows you just how helpful it is to really keep working on the spiritual path. You will recognize your failures, and you'll see them quickly, and you'll know what to do, and quickly get back to what is helpful and avert a crisis in your life. You will easily avert these crises and keep your momentum going really strongly in the right direction. Amazing, huh? It is amazing. So when we say, what's the payoff? Well, when everybody's into panic mode and they're eating, you know, 3 chocolate bars a day, you know, we're going in the right direction. And how great is that? Because once you go into panic mode, all defenses, you start clutching at straws, and it's like free fall. You end up developing severe mental defenses and dissociations, and become psychotic, essentially. The world's likely to become very psychotic. The whole planet, 99% of it, or whatever percentage, high percentage, is likely to become very, very psychotic very soon. Very disassociated within the mind. And this likely to happen very quickly. The guys asked me today, I was with hanging out with a bunch of young guys, and they said, get some food. There's a big party, a buffet, and it's free. I said, nah, I'm, they said, what do you eat? I said, I just mostly juice and fruit juice. They're like, huh? Really? Kind of like, huh? They're thinking like, they didn't put me down, but it's kind of like, Because they were just scarfing out. They were spread crunchers, man. Their plates were full of tacos and everything. They were just, and this is also when you start feeling despair and panic, what you do is you try to make yourself heavier, some more solid feeling. And you overeat. You overeat. You go binge eating. So people will be binge eating to try and stave off psychosis. They'll be binge eating. They'll be binge everything. Binge sexing, binge dancing, binge eating, binge drugging. You name it. We're headed for binging in this world. But that's not doing anything to stop the psychosis at all, actually. It's part of it. It's part of it. And most, well, that's strong stuff, isn't it? Yeah. I don't want to keep. I don't want to binge talk here. let the wow sink in. That's good. Stay on the juice diet. Stay on the fresh fruit diet. I don't know what I'm going to do tomorrow, but I will find some way to get a hold of some fruit and maybe some vegetables and keep on just drinking that. Drink it. Get skinnier, get more flexible, lighter on your feet and more nimble. Don't be sluggish. Boy, the combination of that binge eating that goes into drugs, goes into decadence, goes into all this stuff, the whole world becomes psychotic, and then it can go into war also. Scapegoating goes into furious scapegoating, which is a sign of psychosis, and then severe hatred, and then the whole mind becomes very, you know, it's if you're out of my side, I hate you, you know, you're a complete threat to me, I hate you, and it becomes paranoid, you get paranoia, and to try to defend against paranoia, and you start then trying to split your mind, you get multiple personalities, it goes into psychosis. There's no question about it. We talk about that. Well, again, I don't want to overload. The Holy Spirit says, don't overload. So if I want to say something, I feel resistance, I realize, back off. It's not flowing smoothly, easily. I have to force it. Don't force it. It means there's too much wow involved. So we're just getting used to this. Trust in the Holy Spirit. Not formulistically, not structurally, conceptually, word-wise. Just simple trust the Holy Spirit. I trust you. You're my life is in your hands now. My future is in your hands, Holy Spirit. Just say that. My future is in your hands, Holy Spirit. I place my future in your hands. This is called surrender. Surrender on the spiritual path. They say surrender to the Guru. But ultimately, it's surrendering to God's grace, which is the Holy Spirit. Surrender to the Holy Spirit. My future, I put my future, it's not my future, it's your future now. And I'm just going to experience your future that you have for me. That's why they say, I died and Christ was born in me. The Christian thing, St. Paul. Meaning, you trust in the Holy Spirit. It's like your life dies, but there's a better life that's given to you in this dying of your life. The Holy Spirit gives you its version of your future. So we'll see how that plays out. All right, very great. This is a lot of fun. A lot of fun. More skating is fun. Taping is fun. I haven't done much skating, but the one little bit I did, it's kind of fun. It's like, whoa. Back when you're a kid, for like first doing something, riding your bike, like it's really fun. Like I'm moving on a bicycle. It's so much fun. Speaking of that, binge bicycle riding is going to happen. Very much so. Very much so. Very much so. It's my Holy Spirit's getting my attention on that. And men and women are extremely into mountain biking and biking right now, at least in the Bay Area. I think worldwide, very much into it, almost fanatically into it. You would have to say they're maybe almost as fanatical as the men, and soon they will be. And there's going to be binge bicycle riding. People are going to try to exhaust their despair Okay. Trying to exhaust their despair. Ah, it's interesting definition of exhaustion, right? The ego tells us we can exhaust our despair. And what we do, they'll go on binge bicycle riding, marathon bicycle riding. There'll be all sorts of marathons happening. And you know, they'll go like all day long mountain biking, all weekend long mountain biking, 3 day weekends, all 3 day weekends mountain biking, until they're just like, you're just completely trashed physically, psychologically, mentally, emotionally, their mind, and they're trying to exhaust the despair. They think the despair is coming from the body, so they're trying to exhaust the body. So, and they're trying to fixate. If I just fixate on this bicycle riding, this is healthy for me. So look for tremendous binge bicycle riding coming up. This is just one example of binging. They'll be binging in every which way. So, but we don't binge. We 360 degree wow. Okay. So we get a wow here, we wow it. We get a wow here, we wow it. We get a wow here, we wow it. We don't allow ourselves to get pulled into this binge mentality. Very important. Very important. We do not allow ourselves to get pulled into this binge mentality through full stop on the wow. When you get enough, you just wow it. That's it. Now, choosing a different idea is not binging. Binging is staying with the ego's notion of modifying effects of an idea and then having a psychosis because of that as you go into despair and trying to avoid it through despair, through a psychosis, then trying to avoid the psychosis through binging. It's that what we're talking about. But staying with the idea of the Holy Spirit, that's not binging because it's not an attempt to get rid of anything. Binging is an attempt to get rid of despair. Whereas in the Holy Spirit's future for us, there's no despair. There's no despair. So that's not binging. Abidance is not the same as binging at all. Okay, apples and oranges. Completely different context. Of course, the ego doesn't understand that. Say it's the same context. It's not. It's not. There'll be parties, you know, binge parties. People will become eccentric and erratic and psychotic. I mean, the whole planet, the whole globe is going to be psychotic, actually. And this will be expressed in all this binge activity of all different types. It's already, you know, very much evident. It just hasn't become virulent. Virulency is something that happens in this world. Look at history, and it's a history of virulency. I'm surprised I can even say the word like that. I haven't used that word very much, virulency. I don't know if I've ever used it, but that's a word, right? Virulency, it's a great word. The history of the world is history of virulency, where suddenly what are trends become virulent, become very nasty, very strong. And the wheels come off. That's history. This is what happens here in this existence. This is how existence, this is how it rolls, this is how it works. This is how it works. But we don't have, since we can choose the Holy Spirit to present the future to us, we're not stuck in existence. We can first experience a reduced intensity zone, and then ultimately the death-free realm, and then ultimately we even drop the absurd notion that we need to have the idea that we're free, because we are free, ultimately. So that's the road that we can take and will take. And escape the virulency of this globe here. This globe, escape the virulency. Got to. You don't want to go through that virulency. Believe me. Having gone through it, I know what it's all about. It's like skating down Hoover Dam, okay? You don't want to do that. You want to get off Hoover Dam. And we will. We will. Just put your faith in the Holy Spirit. And I don't care what sort of polemics anybody applies to this. Like, hey, well, that's not really cool. It's not that hip. You know, yeah, it's kind of, nah, it's not really. No, it's completely hip. It's completely cool. It's completely the right thing to do. It's unspeakably, unteachably the right thing to do. It's unspeakably, unteachably the right move to make. And there's nothing more that can be said about it. Because the ego, again, there's nothing to teach the ego at all. So it's unspeakably the right thing to do. Unspeakably and unteachably the right move to make. And that's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. So hang in here with us here, with the Dharma Prince, who's working for the Dharma King, who's working for the Holy Spirit, who's working for God. All right? This is how it goes. God, Holy Spirit, Dharma King, Dharma Prince, and courtiers. All right? You're a courtier. You're a courtier. Be a great courtier right now, okay? Be a great courtier. Courtier listens to the Dharma Princess, the court of a Dharma King, and then there's Dharma Princes in that court that help the courtiers get used to the court, okay? So be a great courtier. Really be serious about it. Very serious. Very, very serious. This is your goal in life. I want to be a great courtier. Great courtier. I had to fast track my own life to severely so I could be a Dharma Prince and help the courtiers out. It was very intense, to say the least. But helpful. I didn't have anything else to do, really, so I might as well. But I wouldn't want to do it again. No, the intensity is very strong. So be a real serious professional courtier. Really listen and hear what's being said here and take it to heart. You know, putting your life in the hands of the Holy Spirit is unspeakably and unteachably the right move. And that's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. How are we doing here? Great. We're doing great. All right. Well, it's getting fairly late. I did rest for an hour and a half this afternoon. I was so exhausted. You know, it's just, we're really, again, we're getting to it now. I mean, this is Labor Day. We're going to be, well, actually, today's the 2nd of September. Are we not just 2 months away from the American election? Yeah, we are, aren't we? Isn't that insane? Can't we postpone it? Well, no, because then 44 would continue his thing. All three options are like panicky, aren't they? We postponing it's as bad as not postponing it. Hey, this is like, wow. Holy Spirit time. Oh, the fourth option, Holy Spirit time. We have this fourth option, don't we? Not this, not that, and not that, but the Holy Spirit, fourth option. Turn our future over to the Holy Spirit. Turn your future, trust in the Holy Spirit. I turn my, not that I'm still manipulating my future, but Holy Spirit, my life is now in your hands. It's your life now, not mine. It's your life now to live and present to me as you live it. Look at it this way, wonderful turnaround, like a 180. But you're still going in the same direction. Just you shifted your perspective. You did a 180. I got to practice the skateboard on pushing my other foot, facing the other direction. I've never tried that before. I used to be very ambidextrous, but you get so used to doing something one way, you start to get fixated on it. When I was young, I did everything both ways. I could do both ways. I was both right-handed and left-handed. Ambidextrous. I could hammer with my left hand. I could hammer with my right hand. I could even write with both hands. If I wanted to train myself now, it wouldn't be difficult to write with either hand. And I swing baseball bat both ways. I don't pitch left-handed. I never practiced that, but you know, I could. When I was young, I could do anything both ways. But you know, you basically kind of fixate on one way or the other. Try to be really good at it. But I always try to do things both ways. Kick a ball with either foot. Gives you an advantage in athletics if you're really ambidextrous, actually. Because you're not favoring either side. You're just in the moment. You're in the moment. And you stay balanced. And you go either way. You're not favoring either side at all. So be mentally, spiritually ambidextrous in this way. And don't fixate. So we have this fourth option, the Holy Spirit. Turning our lives over to the Holy Spirit. We turn our lives, there's no more fixation because the Holy Spirit that's living our life now in a 360-degree manner. And everything is grace. Everything that happens is just grace. I'm aware of like ahead of time friend requests on Facebook now. I'm actually aware the Holy Spirit tips me off that someone with this motif is going to ask to be your friend. And son of a gun, boom, yes. Someone with this motif is going to ask your friend, son of a gun, there's their, you know, their profile picture. Exactly matches what the Holy Spirit showed me prior to any friend request. Prior to it. This is happening now. And I okay the requests. It's something that's show me. The Holy Spirit's wants to show me something. That's why. Okay. I get some odd requests. I've had some odd requests actually here and there. I'll tell you the truth. It's I don't know why. But the Holy Spirit knows. Just stay with the flow. Keep your faith in the Holy Spirit. Unspeakably, unteachably, right choice. Unspeakably, unspeakable, unteachable, the Holy Spirit, right choice. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. And that's it for this one. I think, yeah, still going. Let me see.